Welcome. I'm so glad to have this time with you all tonight. We had some issues here for a minute, and I was afraid that we weren't going to have a decent signal. So y'all just be praying. Just be praying. My God, I just got out of church about an hour and a half ago, and we had a tremendous time in the Lord. And tonight I want to jump right in. We're dealing with my book, The Father-Daughter Talk. And we're in chapter number 4 now. Brother Sheldon, anything I need to remember, you know, leave me a note.
Yes, sir.
Leave me a note. We're in chapter number 4, and we're talking about never tolerating a man that makes you afraid. Never live with a man that makes you afraid. Never live with a man that makes you afraid. The Father-Daughter Talk is a series of discussions that every woman should have had with her father. And one of those discussions is, never live with a man that makes you afraid. Let me just adjust this a bit. Never tolerate a man that makes you afraid. Always read the signals. The reality of abuse is more prevalent than we want to accept. Watch this. Even in the church, women who are physically, emotionally, and verbally abused are usually so embarrassed by it, they share it with no one. Little boys, you know, I was thinking about this. Little boys fight with little girls. But grown men protect women from harm. Whenever you find a man that would be aggressive towards you as a woman, in any fashion, verbally, emotionally, certainly physically, it is an indication that you should move on. Are y'all there? Now, here's the profile of an abusive man. Y'all keep talking to me or doing something so I can know you're there, because I never know when the signal. You know, I'm paranoid. Here's the profile of an abusive man. Usually he was not raised to understand manhood. These are some of the questions a young woman should ask a man when dating. You know, what was your relationship like with your father? How were you raised? Pay attention to how he was raised. He's usually not raised to understand manhood. Or if he was raised to understand it, he didn't get the lesson. Number two, he's insecure and he wants to control. Any man that wants to be, that is overly controlling, there's a seed in him somewhere, and you need to be cautious. Number three, he's usually a coward with other men. He'll talk to you harshly, but he'll show none of that aggression with other guys. If you look in 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 7, it says, likewise ye husbands, dwell with them, the wives, according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers be not hindered. And that term honor means, watch this, to value her, to esteem her to the highest degree, and it means to, watch this, handle her preciously. Handle her preciously, not aggressively, not carelessly. Handle her preciously. Let me tell you something. The moment a man handles you in a fashion that sends off a signal, run. Any man that is not wise enough to understand your value and is not wise enough to handle you preciously, run. My wife and I have been married for 20 years, and I've never called my wife out of her name. She's never had an inkling that I would in any way be physical with her. I've never disrespected my wife. Handle her preciously. Any man that talks to you, talks down to you, talks aggressively, handles you aggressively, is not the one. Here's some wisdom. Every woman should pay attention to a man when he gets frustrated. How quickly does he go from 0 to 10? You may call it road rage, but I call it a signal. If you're riding with a man and somebody cross in front of him and all of a sudden he throwing out a bunch of blankety blanks and winding the window down and reaching for stuff and all that kind of thing. Road rage today, room rage tomorrow. Watch his short temper with you when things are not going his way. If you disagree with him, watch how quickly he gets angry with you. See how far he takes it. These are signals. These are signs. You got to read the signpost. A man, listen to this carefully. A man in the life of a woman, listen to this, should produce the absence of fear and anxiety. When a woman gets a man, the man is supposed to produce for the woman a sense of security, the absence of fear. When she has a man, she now says, I don't have to worry about nothing because my man got me. She shouldn't have to be concerned that the harm is coming from within. The man is supposed to remove the absence of anxiety and fear from without. When I'm home and I'm not traveling, I notice something. My wife rarely puts on the alarm because I'm home. When I'm gone, she puts the alarm on automatically. But when I'm home, she doesn't put it on. Why? Because as a husband, I represent her protector, her security, not her terrorist. And there are many of you who are dating men that you're afraid of. You're afraid of his temper. You're afraid of his attitude. And you know what? Run, Forrest, run. Run, Forrest, run. Colossians 3 and 19 says, husbands, love your wives and be not bitter against them. Any man who has such anger issues that he can't control his temper is not ready for a wife. Now, you know, when you think about this society, the glamorization of the abuse of women is prevalent. You know, right now the big thing is everybody wants to be a pimp. And it's a big thing to be a pimp, which is what? A manipulator of women, an abuser of women, an emotional and physical abuser of women. And we glamorize this stuff. And our daughters, psychologically, they don't think that anything's wrong with it. And then you have these little boys that's treating them like dogs in the street, and emotionally abusing them and dragging them and, you know, pulling their self-esteem down. And the question is, why do women accept this behavior? Listen to this. She doesn't believe that she's worth more. The women accept it because they don't believe in their hearts that they are worth more than that kind of behavior. It's also becoming you know, just the glamorization of victimizing womanhood. It's also becoming more prevalent because we are having fewer and fewer women raised with fathers who are present physically, emotionally, and financially. And a woman without a present father becomes a target, and she is left vulnerable emotionally and physically. And in her search for love, the love she should have gotten from her father, she often entertains predators unaware. He slides into the cracks that her father left and situates himself in her life. He plays mind games. Number one, he'll do stuff like befriending your kids. You'll try to get to know your kids really quickly. That's why you're not supposed to be running all these men into your house, introducing these men to your children. You don't bring all these bunch of men into the lives of your children. Number one, your children ain't not supposed to even have an image of you dating a bunch of men that you're not married to. You don't bring no man into the lives of your children until you know he's the one. You on the second date, you bringing this man. Now he befriending your children. He's a predator. Number two, he pulls her away from all of her support system. He talks you away from your family. He talks you away from your church. If you have a good pastor who's really a spiritual father and is going to tell you the truth, he talks you away from that. He says, oh, no, I'm not feeling Pastor so-and-so. Come on over here with me. And he pulls you out of there before you even have a firm understanding of who he is. Separates you from your mama. And then thirdly, he becomes a major source, sometimes financially. He'll try to talk you out of education. Don't worry about getting no more degrees. Don't worry about that. You don't need a job. You don't need another job. I got you. What he's doing is he's making you totally dependent on him so that when he really uncovers who he really is, you are in a position that you cannot move out of. Am I still communicating? Watch this. And then he changes. Now you had seen little small things all the way coming along, but what happened was you were so busy trying to make some relationship work, you weren't paying attention to the character of this man. You in love with the idea of marriage, so much so that you didn't have an understanding, or you lacked understanding to see, rather, that you didn't have marriage material here. Many women feel imprisoned. Now listen to this carefully, because this is important. Many women feel imprisoned in an abusive relationship because they need the money. Because they need the money. Hebrews 13 and 6 says this, watch this. So that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man shall do unto me. The Lord is always your source. You don't have to settle for an abusive relationship just because of money. Change your lifestyle, downgrade your lifestyle, but be free. Go back home to your mama, your daddy, but be free. Don't live in an abusive relationship just because of money. This is why you got to stop running around here and failing to educate yourself and failing to take care of your financial business, because it makes you a slave to men who will use that to abuse you. So you got to trust God to provide for you. Now, the first step out of this kind of situation is to face your fears. You got to face your fears. You got to face your fears. See, most male abusers are cowards when challenged. Most male abusers are cowards when challenged. And they even know what kind of woman to play this with. They know what kind of woman to play this with. There are certain women that they're not going to even deal with because they know they ain't got nothing but a fight in her. You saw what happened with Ike when Tina punched him in his eye. You saw how that situation changed. Now, you remember the color purple? When Miss Seeley pointed her fingers at Mr. You saw how that changed? Most abusers are cowards, and when you challenge them, the coward will come out. But you got to make up your mind that you're going to face your fears. You can't be so afraid that you get locked up in a cage of fear to a man that doesn't even deserve a conversation with you. Look what the Bible says. Well, let me read this. A man that hurts you, a woman, in the slightest bit, intentionally, does not love you. A man that hurts you intentionally does not love you in the slightest bit. Now, as men, we hurt women all the time. You know, I hurt my wife's feelings. I don't be knowing. And she tell me, she start crying, and I apologize. But my wife can tell you, I've never hurt my wife intentionally. And I've never gotten aggressive with my wife. I've never gotten physical with my wife. I've never been verbally abusive to my wife. A man that hurts you intentionally does not love you. Ephesians 5:28-29 says, so ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself. For no man ever yet hated his own flesh, but nourisheth and cherisheth it, even as the Lord the church. When a man loves you, he will hurt himself before he hurts you. A man that loves you is not going to hurt you. Oh, his nerves was bad, pal. He was stressed out. Stressed out. You mean tell me that's why he punched you in your eye? Because he was stressed out? Why he didn't punch them dudes in the eye on the call before he got home? Why he wait to get home to punch you in the eye? He doesn't love you. He's a little boy, an angry little boy. He's not a man. He's a coward. He's garbage. And the sooner you get out of this situation. Oh, Lord, I need some water, man. Good God, right now. Let me watch this. Now what happens is it starts with, see, this is where it starts. It starts with rude and hurtful statements to dismantle your self-esteem. It then progresses. You gotta pay attention to every form of disrespect a man might throw at you. Watch this. And don't write it off. Don't sweep it under the rug. Every form of disrespect, from the first disrespectful word, you have to verbalize the fact that you're not going to stand for this. You have to make him know this is not going to fly here. You don't let no man just start talking crazy to you, and then he escalates. No. You got to learn to cut it off at the knees. You never let a man disrespect you. You don't let him talk to you crazy, and if you cut him off there, he's not going to be around long enough to get to the point where he put his hands on you. He got to the point where he could put his hands on you because you let him disrespect you for so long, and that thing kept escalating, that seed kept growing. Watch this. Now, listen to this. This is important. When you challenge him, he will blame his behavior on some personal struggle he's having. I'm stressed out. They're not treating me right on the job. I wish I could make more money. I want to do better for the family. I'm so sorry. He's always sorry, but he's never changing. And he blames his behavior, his aggression towards you, on something he's dealing with on the inside. Well, if he has that much going on the inside, he needs personal time. He doesn't need anybody else. He doesn't need anybody else. And you don't need no woman in your life when you got so many issues in going on the inside of you that you're jumping on a defenseless woman. And you sitting there, you making excuses for this man. You won't even call the police on this man. You won't even call the police on this man. This man went upside your head, and you won't even call the police on this man. You sitting there, you got ice on your eye, and you feeling sorry for this, hallelujah, this man. Women, again, get stuck in abusive relationships because they're fantasizing about some miraculous change. Oh, Pastor, you know, everybody deserves a second chance. No, no, no. Third, fourth, 100, 200. And to be quite honest with you, when somebody go up upside your head, they don't deserve no second chance. Then you get these stupid people in the church, these religious people, that'll tell you when you're in a physically abusive relationship that you should go back and trust God. Go back for what? To get killed? You fantasize about, oh, he gonna change. Pastor, he gonna change. God gonna do something for him. And you in the hospital. You missing a month and a half of church. We don't know where you at. It's because you all beat up and you can't come out in public. And you making excuses for this man. A wise woman knows when to step out of her emotions. And I'm done. And to step into common sense. You've gone through this long enough. Now it's time to cut your losses and to move on and progress. When a thing is dead, you bury it. The day a man put his hands on you, the relationship is dead. Bury it. I don't care how many children you had for him. You may have had 30 children for him. When he put his hands on you, the relationship is dead. It ain't nothing else to talk about. You don't need no counseling. You don't need no prayer line. It's dead. You need another address. Now, you will either get one or I'm getting one. But we're not living in the same house. And don't put your hands on me no more. I'm going to figure something out. You don't let no man just put his hands on you like that. Read Luke chapter 13, 6. Let me read it for you. 6 through 9, and I'm shutting it down here. He spake also this parable. A certain man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came and sought fruit thereon and found none. Expecting what this thing was supposed to produce, found none. Then said he unto the dresser of his vineyard, behold, these 3 years I come seeking fruit on this fig tree and find none. Cut it down. Why cumbereth it the ground? Why let it take up space when it's producing nothing? And he answering said unto him, Lord, let it alone this year also, till I shall dig about it and dung it, fertilize it. And if it bear fruit, well. And if not, then after that thou shalt cut it down. Jesus said, there's an expiration date on certain things. When a thing is dead, you cut it down. When a man puts his hands on you, the relationship is dead. Cut it down. Ooh. Now, Sunday, today is Thursday, right? Yeah, Sunday, we're going to go into chapter 4, which is, let me see if I can get that for y'all. See that? Man, I'm confused. Chapter 5, I'm sorry. We're going into chapter 5. We just did 4. A woman must always, y'all reading that? Woman must always be prepared to earn her own money. A lot of times you're stuck in these abusive relationships because you have not learned to earn your own money. You need these people's monies and they take advantage of you. Every woman should be prepared to earn her own money. This is the age of the power couple. Powerful man and a powerful woman come together to create an empire. The day of high heels and low IQs is over. The Marilyn Monroe era is over. It's over. This is the Michelle Obama era. You got to be educated, beautiful, and you got to know how to stand your own ground. You got to learn to earn your own money. Every father would tell his daughter that. I don't want any of my daughters depending on an undependable man. I made a point of making certain that all of my daughters, my biological daughters, are self-sufficient financially. I should be the last man they have to depend on financially. Now, God bless them with great husbands that will do all of that. Praise God. But if not, I can close my eyes and go on to heaven and know my girl's good. They ain't gonna need no man for no money. Learn to earn your own money. All right. Brother Shelton, I might need your help again tonight. All right, here we go, here we go, here we go. Don't forget to connect with me on all of my various social media outlets. Of course, you know Periscope. And also follow my wife at Ellen Blakes. Find me on Instagram at RC Blakes. Facebook, RC Blakes Jr. You can follow my wife, Lisa Blakes, on Facebook as well. Twitter, RC underscore Blakes. And YouTube, Robert Blakes. My email address is pastorrcblakes@gmail.com. Brother Shelton, come in and just talk about what we got going on now. Yeah, let me see if I can get out the way. Tell them what are you offering right now?
Right now what we're offering is...
come on in a little more.
What we're offering right now, we have the study guide to the Father-Daughter Talk book. This is the study guide that goes along with the Father-Daughter Talk book. And if you'd like to purchase this, you can do so by going to Pastor's website on tonight. You can get the combo, what we call the combo, and you can get the study guide along with the book for $25, along with shipping and handling.
Are you still going to send them the DVD?
Yes. Also, when you purchase the combo, again, that's the study guide along with the Father-Daughter Talk book, we're going to send to you the Get Your Life Sexual Integrity DVD that will be included in the combo package.
Amen, amen, amen.
Again, well, that's for $25, Pastor.
Amen.
Plus shipping and handling.
I love you guys. I love you guys. I'll see you Sunday night. Sunday night at 10 p.m. Central Standard Time. We'll go into Chapter 5. Go into Chapter 5. Don't forget to meet me in the morning, 7:30 a.m. Central Standard Time. I'll be on with the radio show, and then we'll have Morning Manna following the radio show at 8 a.m. We'll have about 15, 20 minutes of word. Those of you in the New Orleans area, well, I don't have the address. Okay, what is the address? Tomorrow night, those of you in the New Orleans area, I need you all to meet me at one of my daughter's church. I'm going to be preaching at tomorrow night for 7 o'clock?
7:30
tomorrow night. What's the address?
4501 Dowman Road.
4501 Dowman Road in East New Orleans. What's the name of the church? Come on, son. Your eyes younger.
Doesn't say.
That's glorious.
What is the address again?
The address is 4501 Dowman
Road. 4501 Dowman Dowman Road. Tomorrow night for 7:30. You all meet me there. I want to go and be a blessing to her. It's her pastoral anniversary. I love you. I thank God for you. Anything I'm missing? Don't forget to go to my website, rcblakes.com, and sign up for my database. We're getting ready to start sending a lot of stuff to those who are in my database. Go there and sign up. And I look forward to talking with you guys Sunday night. And again, those of you, I saw somebody mentioning something about this DVD. The title of this DVD is Sexual Integrity. And it was from, I played a little bit of it last night. What was it? Last night. And this was from
January
of this year, a Father-Daughter Talk experience. For a love gift of any size, those of you who desire to have it, we will send it to you. Just try to cover that shipping at least. What is the shipping?
Shipping range is right at about $10.
Yeah. So just try to cover that shipping, and we'll get it out to you. But I love you. I thank God for you. I'm going home and get some sleep now. I love you. God bless you. Let me pray for you before I let you go tonight. Father, I thank you for this time that we've had together. And now, God, I pray for every person, every woman that is dealing with the very subject that I was talking about tonight. My prayer, Father, is that you will bring healing for their souls in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Bring healing for their souls. And as I speak to them, God, let them hear the voice. Let them hear your voice, God, speaking to their hearts and bringing healing to their souls in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Brother Shelton, can you find, you still have my brother's DVD, CD over there?
Yes, sir.
Can you pull up Scars for me? Don't y'all forget to go and get my brother's download my brother's project, I Survived. Man, this is unbelievable. I want you to hear we're gonna go off with this here. This is the cut that has been released recently with he and Bishop Martin. You think we can do it, Brother Shaw?
Yes, I'm trying to get it loaded.
All right. Whoo. All right. I run out of stuff to say, Brother Shaw. You got to get this music playing now. Praise the Lord. Oh, just know I love y'all. Just got to turn it up louder than that. Go to Scars, brother. Can you go to Scars? I'm trying to get to Scars, but they can't find me. Now they got a radio on. I don't know what's going on. This is a jackleg operation we got going on here. You talk about an Amos and Andy operation. We have an Amos and Andy operation here tonight. I want y'all to know that.
It's coming now,
man. He says it's coming now. It's coming now, y'all. The man says it's coming now. But I'm the one with my face in his camera, looking country and crazy. I love y'all. Listen to this. Of you that are in the city of New Orleans, you can come right here to the bookstore, which I'm standing in tonight at 1605 Robert C. Blake Senior Drive, formerly Carondelet Street. You can pick this up, or you can pick up any of the items that I've been talking about relative to books and what have you. Got a lot of my dad's stuff in here as well, all kinds of stuff in here. So stop by
tomorrow to 1 o'clock.
Tomorrow the bookstore will be open from 9 a.m. until 1 p.m. If you're in the city of New Orleans and you just want to come and pick it up, it's here. The books, the manuals, the CD, all of that, the DVD, all of that is here. Love y'all. See you Sunday night. I'll talk to you in the morning. God bless you. Until then.